So strategy five is patient retention. So what I just showed you is a great example of patient retention. I don't think in 20 years in dentistry I've ever heard anyone lecture. I hate that word lecture. It sounds like talking down to you. I don't think I've ever heard anyone speak about patient retention to any length. It's usually like a cursory mention. Oh, yeah, patient retention is important. Well, you know, 10% of your practice dies or moves away every year. That's the stats. I mean, that's just stats I've been reading for years. I don't know if it's true or not, but, you know, let's say it's half that. Well, if you have 3,000 patients and you lose 5% of your patient practice a year, 5% of your base, that's 150 people, and you're only getting 10 new patients a month, are you growing? No, you're shrinking. So this retention thing is a big, big deal. And unfortunately, very few people put time, energy, and effort and thought, strategic thought, into keeping the patients they already have. They're more interested in just ramming new patients through the door. New patients, new patients, new patients. Well, if you can plug the hole in the bottom of the bucket and keep some of those patients from leaving through use of really smart retention strategies, it requires less upfront money to spend on external marketing. You don't need as many new patients. So if you're able to keep and cut those numbers, the attrition numbers down, through retention strategies, you don't have to spend as much money on external marketing. So it's hugely expensive. To combat it, you can show appreciation. Chris had some awesome strategies up here this morning when he was talking about how they're engaging their patients through social media, which I hate social media, but that's just a personal bias. I'm not on it. I don't like it. And, you know, it's troublesome for kids, I think. And so I just have decided that I hate it. And I speak out about it quite often. There are a couple of great ways to combat retention or, you know, combat attrition. Recognition, routine contact. One of the things we do in our dental office is every month, every single one of our regular patients, and I think I brought it up here, gets a postcard from us. On this giant 6x11 full color postcard is usually some fun facts and an offer to our existing patients. If you come in during the month of July, sealants are $99 for a full mouth for kids. So we have some kind of offer every month that's going to our existing patient base. So what we're doing is we're doing two things. We're increasing the recency and the frequency of patient visits. So instead of them maybe never getting sealants or never getting an implant consultation or whatever the offer happens to be that month, we're increasing those numbers just by marketing to our existing patients. We don't have to pay for a mailing list. Postage is cheap at like 22 or 23 cents a piece because we're sending bulk mail and printing's cheap. I mean, you know, printing isn't that expensive. You can get 2,500 postcards in the mail through your local printer for, you know, $1,200, $1,300. I mean, it's pretty darn cheap. And it's an extremely effective way to maintain that contact and help kill the attrition. This regular contact, if you're using like direct mail, we also send a newsletter to our patients every month. We have about 1,100 newsletters that go out every month. Not every patient of record gets it. We are pretty picky about who we invest our money into. So if the patient's a turd, they're not getting anything from us. We're not going to spend our money on it. We'd rather they go somewhere else. So we're picky about who goes on that list. Just because you have a heartbeat and you had $99 at one point when you show up for our office, if we don't like you, we're not going to market to you. If we like you, we're going to try and duplicate you through smart marketing. So we do that through a newsletter and through the use of the postcards. Plus, we also use email. You know, we send out a couple emails a month. Sometimes it's just a fun fact. Sometimes it's an offer. Sometimes it's through patient recognition. But this regular contact gives you another avenue to ask for referrals without actually having to say, Mary, we're so glad you're here. If you had a good time today, if you love having your teeth pulled and you like spending a lot of money, please send your friends and family. We'll take good care of them. I mean, I've actually heard something similar to that from a doctor one time. I asked him, I go, what do you ask, you know, when you talk to patients about referrals, what do you say? And he said something like that. And I go, really? That sounds like a place I want to go. It gives you a platform, a marketing platform, that you don't have unless you're using. And that regular contact is really, really important. So a couple other ways. Recognition. We have, like Chris talked about, he has that dental health care, I think he called it a plan, in his practice. About 11 years ago we started that. We call ours the Dental Health Care Club. It's all set up. It's really simple. Ours is a little more expensive. It's $29 a month. Chris's, I think, was $14. $29 a month, and they have a whole list of benefits. Actually, I got a brochure that shows what we offer at our booth. I think, yeah, it's at the booth. So if you're interested to see what we do, it's out there. So we talked about mailed newsletters. I'm a huge, huge fan of regular patient mail. I know Dr. Alex does a regular newsletter with us, mails out about 1,000 a month. And by the way, I think you had a record month last month for new patients, 138 or 39 new patients or something like that. This is in Mobile, Alabama, folks. Has an Aspen Dental right next door. And he's killing them. He's just killing them. So his regular direct mail to his patients is paying off big time. So here's a, this is an example of our front page of our brochure, how you and your family can save on every single office visit. And that's a brochure we put together. We use this to increase the number of visits, like Chris said, increase our revenue. And we liken it to insurance. We offer it only to patients that don't have insurance, because those with insurance are already paying a monthly fee for something that's subpar, in my opinion. But we've been running this effectively for 11 years. We charge $29 a month for a single person. They get 2 pro fees a year, exams and x-rays at no cost. They get an emergency exam at no cost. They get, 5% off any dental treatment, plus if they pay in cash, they get another 5%, plus if they're a senior citizen, they get another 5%. And if they're a vet, they're another 5%. So literally with this program, they can save 20% off. Patients love it. And it's a really super easy sell. I mean, I'll use the dirty word sell. But when you have a patient who's brand new to your practice and they're wondering how they're going to afford treatment, we immediately present this to them and go, hey, we understand you don't have insurance. We have this great club. It's called the Dental Healthcare Club. This brochure explains it all. It's really inexpensive, and it saves you a lot of money on your dental care. And it sort of takes the sting out of the cost every time you come in. So we show them the savings. We have a little chart that shows the savings versus, regular fees and then our fees for this. It's a very powerful practice builder. Here's what most don't understand about this. When you have 500 people paying you $29 a month, that's close to $15,000 a month, right? If you look at your P&L, what on your P&L statement can be covered with that 15 grand that's coming in, whether you show up or not? A whole bunch of it, right? Now, when you go to sell your practice, is your practice worth more with a $15,000 a month regular recurring revenue stream, or is it worth less? We have up front here a gentleman, Jay Malik. Jay is a money guy. He works with dentists on money stuff, personal financial as well as practice financial. Jay, what business gets a higher sale price? One with an annuity revenue stream like we've talked about, or one that has episodic income events? Definitely annuity, right? So if you want a practice that's worth more, this is one of the easiest things you can do to raise the value. Every business I've owned has recurring revenue every month coming in. I won't own a business unless I can somehow create a way so that that client is paying every month. Because for me, it's security, it's stability. It allows me to do things in my business that most businesses can't. So in your dental practice, if you can look for ways to create continuity, this is a no-brainer. We created another interesting program a few years ago, the Periodontal Disease Management Program, PDMP. And by the way, the blueprint for all this stuff is part of our membership, ClearPath Society. You get the blueprint to these things, and you can use it. So the Periodontal Disease Management Program takes the sting out of patients who don't have insurance, who need periodontal care, but can't afford $330 a quad. That's a lot of money, folks. If you don't have insurance, for the average person on the street coming into your office to sit and get scraped on and bleed and be in pain for an hour, hour and a half, $330 is a lot of money. Here again, you're selling pain and expense. So we had a lot of people who weren't accepting treatment, and they're walking out. And so I thought, there's got to be, it's the money. It isn't the benefit, because the benefit's pretty clear. We're going to save your teeth. You won't be walking around with wiggly teeth. We use that word, wiggly teeth. Have you ever had a loose tooth? Remember when a kid, you had a loose tooth? That's what happens when you get periodontal disease. Your teeth are going to fall out. Your gums rot and your teeth fall out. Your teeth rot, whatever. So we created this program to make it easy for our patients to say yes. We removed a barrier. Money's a barrier. Take it away. You're going to sell more treatment. That's a big aha for you. That's like a right or downer. If you can take a barrier away from a patient to get them to yes quicker, you're going to get more patients to say yes. You're going to do more treatment. Your collections are going to go up. Mama's going to be happy, or daddy's going to be happy at home. That's the way it works. So the periodontal disease management, we looked at what the average patient does over a year's period of time, or the ideal scenario for a patient undergoing periodontal treatment over a year. We looked at the total cost of that. We discounted it 10%, and we broke it up into 12 payments. We put them on an auto charge plan, a debit, checking, credit, we don't care. How do you want to pay? I want to pay with a debit card. Great, we need a credit card and a checking account as backup. We always get a backup. We don't miss payments. Collections are not an issue for us because we get 2 to 3 ways from every single patient we put on payment plans. And by the way, we finance a lot of dentistry. And that's counter to what everyone in dentistry is going to tell you. Don't be the bank. I'm telling you, I like 18% interest on my profits. I'll let you think about that for a second. 18% interest on your profit. We collect our overhead up front, lab fees, doctor time, we finance the rest. So we finance a lot of crowns. We've got 3 payments in the bank, typically, before we're seating a crown. If we get 3, the financing industry shows if you get 3 payments, you're gonna get almost all of them, almost every time. Our default rate's less than the cost of a credit card swipe. Let me translate that for you. Default rate is 3%. If you process American Express, it's probably 3.5 to 4, which isn't bad. Care Credit's 10, some are 15%. So if you're doing $1,000 worth of treatment, you're out of your pocket, Care Credit's gonna take $100 to give you your money tomorrow. That's their fee, right? And then they're gonna turn around and charge interest to the patient. So what we do, instead of financing it through Care Credit, sometimes we do, but what we like to do is ask the patient, if they can't afford to write a check and they don't qualify for Care Credit, we become the bank and we're happy to do it, especially if we have a relationship with them. But here's the deal. We know our lab fee is gonna be $99 most of the time for a crown, and we know the doctor time is about $100, right? 30% of adjusted collections is what our doctors get. So that's our overhead, that's our big overhead. There's staff time, there's bibs, there's plastic, there's spray goop, but I just want the big stuff and I'll finance the rest. So we get upfront $200 to $250 for our $1,000 crown that day. Case goes off to the lab, and here's one reason why Sarek isn't a good situation here. Case goes off to the lab, you know where I'm going with this, don't you, Jay? Case comes back a couple weeks later, a week later, that patient's not gonna get seated for that crown until we have the second or third payment in the bank. Because statistics tell us if we get 3 payments, the default rate plummets. If we have any collection problems at all, that crown just sits. We don't deliver that baby. So once we get the money and we feel good about the money, the patient gets the crown. And then we get to finance $500 worth of profit at 18%. So if you're financing 100 crowns, $500 of each crown, $50,000 at 18% a year, what's the number? How much? A lot. I like that, right? Now that's a paradigm shift. Have any of you ever heard or thought of that before? Right? Because Care Credit's running around, beating you guys up. You need your money now, don't be the bank. Well, I'm telling you, why are they doing that? What's their motive? They got the biggest building, right? Banks always have the biggest buildings. It's because they're making interest on other people's money. So why don't you be the bank? Yeah? We make a lot of money at 18% a year, every single year. It covers the cost of almost 2 staff members a year in interest. If we didn't charge interest, that money's coming out of my pocket. So I like being the bank. That's big for us. Patient mailing's done right. So we're talking about retention still. This is a really cool example of an outer envelope we designed for one of our members who's now retired. Jeff Prager just retired this year. He sent this envelope here to his patients, his existing patients. There's a little caricature of him. Dinner, a movie, or at-home teeth whitening on us. Details inside. So inside, we've got a letter. Here's a letter. Can we send you to dinner or a movie? This went to all of his patients. There were about 1,200 of them that went out. Inside were a couple of these referral cards, these little buggers here, right? So not only is he asking for a referral, he's offering a bribe. Send us a patient, we're gonna interview you in a drawing, every patient's gonna get something. So this is a really great tool. So he's like, hey, I need to bump up referrals, I'm getting ready to sell, need new patient flow, I wanna do it smartly, I want great new patients for this doctor. So he went to his patient base and asked. So we bribed him with dinner or a movie. Great response. I think I talked to Lisa, his office manager, who is still there with the new doctor, Dr. Kavanaugh, and she said, I'm going from memory, I think it was 20 or 23 new patients that came from this campaign. They were in at about $1,400. 20 to 23 new patients for $1,400. Referrals. So they're predisposed to accept treatment. They're the best kind of new patient you can ask for. patient mailing to existing patients. This next screenshot, I'm using Jeff because Jeff is really creative, and whatever I tell him to do, he would do it. So he was like my dream client. I'd say, hey, Jeff, do this. Okay, we're going to test it. Hey, Jeff, take that retro ad that really worked well in the newspaper, put it in your Valpak ad. Okay, I'll do it. By the way, that was one of the best things he ever ran in Valpak, was a retro coupon that was based on our retro designs that we did for him. Just killed it with Valpak. So this is his newsletter. This is the front page. You will not find anything about dentistry in his newsletter. Here's the second page. Nothing about dentistry. Kids sporting equipment. There's nothing. Here's meet our patient of the month, Jennifer Bernard. I love my dentist. Like us on Facebook, whatever. I don't care about that stuff, but somebody does. And then a little thing about all that. Nah, I can't read it. Anyway, you get the point. This is not a dental newsletter. This is totally non-dental. It's gossip. So here we've got referral rewards program. So here's some of the patients they got in from their referrals. They've got pictures. I love my dentist. This is Lisa, the office manager, one of their patients and a dental assistant, another patient here. So, I mean, this is just, and then a little, oh, there's something about dentistry. It's been over 14 years since Dr. Prager placed mercury in anyone's mouth. But that's it. 34 years of mercury-free dentistry. That's the only thing dental in his newsletter. If you're sending a newsletter out and it has dental stuff in it, please stop. Patients don't care. They don't want to know. It's such a tiny slice of their life. Nothing against you or what you do, but they don't care. They want to know what Mary's up to, what Susie's up to, what you're up to. They don't care about dentistry. They care about the people that are in the office. So if you want an effective dental newsletter, ask for referrals and print gossip. Right? The number one selling thing at the newsstand, gossip. Gossip columns, gossip tabloids, rags. That's like what sells in the newspaper aisle. So why are you trying to sell dentistry through a newsletter? Nobody cares. They want to know what's going on in your office.